G'day, I've recently put together a couple of basic videos on your 12 volt system. Dual batteries, DC-DC chargers, inverters, solar and isolators. And I wanted to get a little bit technical on something that a lot of people ask about and a lot of people get wrong. And that is wire size. Automotive wire is described or marketed with a different set of rules compared to electronics cable. While auto wire is described based on its overall diameter, including insulation, many installs call for a certain wire gauge. So if you'd headed to the parts store and picked up a length of 6mm twin core automotive wire, this is what you'd end up with. Now the interesting thing about this is the overall diameter of the wire, including the insulation, is about 4mm. The diameter of the wire itself is about 2.4 millimeters, which gives you an area of about 4.59 square millimeters. If you wanted 6mm squared cable, you'd need to step up to about a 9 gauge, which gives you about 2.9 millimeter diameter. So you can really easily see the difference here between the 6mm cable and the 6mm squared cable. But if your installation calls for 6 gauge cable, 6 AWG or 6 BNS, you'd need to step up to something this size. That'd give you about 4.1 millimeters of conductor diameter and about 13.3 square mils of area. And finally, if you were using actual 6mm diameter, it'd be this big. 6mm diameter will give you 3 gauge wire. And here's your really easy comparison. This is cold 6mm wire. This has an area of 6 square millimeters. This is actually 6 gauge wire, and this has a wire diameter of 6mm. No wonder it can be so confusing. And there's one other thing you need to look out for, and that is the thickness of the insulation. Check this out. These wires look about the same thickness, but check out the difference once you strip that insulation. Each of these wires has a certain amp rating that you shouldn't exceed. Around 40 amps for the 6mm automotive wire, about 65 amps for the 9 gauge, about 100 amps for the 6 gauge, and about 150 amps for the 3 gauge. As we said before, the maximum amp rating for 6mm automotive twin core wiring is 40 amps. So you might be tempted to use it for something like a 20 amp DC-DC charger, but you have to take into account that that's its maximum amp rating at 25 degrees ambient and over a certain length. Double the length and you double the resistance. And for every degree above 25 degrees ambient, resistance increases as well. So if this wire was at 45 degrees, it'd be an 8% increase in resistance. So it's important to know the amp rating of the wire gauge you're using, but it's also important to remember voltage drop. The thinner or longer the wire you're using, the more resistance, and the more resistance in the wire, the more voltage drop. That's why it's so important to use the correct gauge of wire and not add any unnecessary length. I'm going to use my DC power supply to run a pair of powerful 12 volt spotlights. Then I'm going to use two different gauges of wire and demonstrate the massive difference in voltage drop between the two. Now this can be set to exactly 14 volts and it'll stay there. I'll connect up the thin wire to the power supply and then to the driving lights. Then I'll use my multimeter set to voltage to measure the difference between the start and end of the wire. So you saw there was about 14 volts coming out of the power supply and we were losing around 2 volts through the circuit at the start of the test. By the end of the test, we were nearly at 3 volts because this wire was heating up, increasing the resistance and sending more current through. Then I'll connect my thick wire the same way. And keep in mind, these are the same length overall. Again, I connect up the positive wire, attach my multimeter and start the test. This time the voltage drop is a tiny 27 millivolts, about 100 times less than the thin wire. The amps were so much higher in the first test because the resistance in the thin wire was drawing much more power and converting it into heat. In a dual battery system, that's just wasted energy that could have been used to charge your second battery. So in that test you saw, we were only losing 27 millivolts along this wire. That means that the amps didn't climb because the resistance wasn't there and the voltage wasn't dropping. You can estimate voltage drop using some pretty simple maths if you want to check your own installs too. times the current of the appliance in amps by the length of wire to the appliance in meters by 0.017. That's the resistivity of copper. And then divide that number by the area of the wire in millimeters squared. So for example, a 20 amp DC-DC charger over 8 meters of wire times 0.017, then divided by 4.59, which is the area of the 6 millimeter automotive wire, gives you 0.59 volts of voltage drop. Then you need to consider the length back to the first battery on your earth return. Double your answer for total voltage drop, that's 1.18 volts. You can adjust the above equation for temperature too. If your wire is at 25 degrees, use 0.017, but if it's more like an ambient of 30 degrees, use 0.0177. For 40 degrees, use 0.0184, and for 50 degrees, use 0.0191. How hot do you think the underside of your vehicle gets while you're working hard in low range? At 50 degrees, you get 1.33 volts of voltage drop. The hotter it gets, the more voltage drop. So if you think 6 millimeter automotive wire with its max amp rating of 40 amps is enough for your 20 amp DC-DC charger, then think again. You should aim for less than 3% voltage drop in your system. 3% of 13 volts is 0.39 volts. At 50 degrees Celsius, this example is already over 10%. That voltage drop will seriously affect the performance of your charging system. Finally, if you're planning to run your earth back through your vehicle's chassis and body, and you might think you've got plenty of metal and area to play with, you have to be aware that steel has about 10 times higher resistance than copper. You never know quite how well it's all connected, and it makes it very difficult to calculate the voltage drop. So if you want a really efficient and effective 12 volt system, make sure you run a heavy duty wire all the way back to the earth terminal of your battery. Remember back to part one where we talked about your standard alternator that can put out about 14 volts. The obvious problem with voltage drop is that if you're running power from the front of your vehicle all the way to the back and you're losing 1 or 2 volts, by the time it reaches the battery in the back, it won't be high enough to charge. The problem's made even worse if you've got a temperature compensating alternator. While it's dropping the voltage for the battery under the bonnet to suit the ambient temperature down to say 13 volts, if you're losing 1 or 2 volts between the front and the rear of the vehicle, you're already down to 12 or 11 volts, way less than you'd need. That's why it's so important to use the right gauge of wire. The final thing to get into before you start running wiring through your vehicle is safety. Running a positive cable from your battery requires a fuse or circuit breaker as close to the battery as possible. So if you're running a dual battery system and connecting both batteries, you'll need a fuse at both ends. In an electrical circuit, the fuse is designed to blow or melt when a certain current flows through it. They're labeled with an amp rating and available anywhere from milliamps to hundreds of amps in size. You need to match the fuse size to the circuit or accessory that it's protecting. If your driving lights need 10 amps to light up and you put a 1 amp fuse in, the fuse will blow before the lights illuminate. On the other hand, if you use a fuse that's too large on thin wire, the wire will melt before the fuse blows, and that's not good. Here's an extreme example. I'm putting a 300 amp fuse on this thin wire here and short circuiting it onto a battery. Short circuiting this battery means it's able to put out 3000 amps of current. So be careful whenever you're tightening battery terminals. Bridge the terminals and you'll definitely see some sparks. The other thing to be aware of is any jewelry, whether it's rings, watches, bracelets, or necklaces, because if they arc out, it'll hurt. And while you're hooking everything in your dual battery system together, take the fuses out. That way nothing's live while you're working. Let's look at a basic dual battery system that I've mocked up without fuses. So we've got our main power lead and a basic isolator connecting the positive terminals, and we've got a separate earth lead, plus our starter battery is earthed to the vehicle's chassis. Imagine the main positive lead was wearing on a sharp part of your vehicle's chassis or body, and eventually it contacted. Without a fuse, the current would be free to go through the whole circuit, heating up the battery, damaging your 12 volt system, and potentially your vehicle. And that's why you need a fuse at both positive terminals of both batteries. If there is a short circuit, it'll blow and protect your vehicle. That's why it's so important to use the correct wire gauge, account for any voltage drop, and don't take any shortcuts as your 12 volt system will suffer. Plus, make sure you're protecting yourself, your vehicle, and your 12 volt accessories with the correct fuses. Use the right gear and you'll get years of enjoyment out of your 12 volt setup. As always, if there's any questions, make sure you throw them in the comments below. Make sure you like and subscribe to the channel and check out all the other videos we have on offer, whether it's four-wheel driving and camping, cooking, or more 12 volt off-grid bush power tips, tricks, and techniques.